God, merciful Father.
I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. And I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you, O Lord God, with mercy, and with the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in this stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The strength of his people, he is the same.
my sinful desire in this life. Therefore, dear Father, forgive us these sins and let your Holy Spirit cleanse our hearts, that we may desire and love your word, abide by it, and by your grace be forever saved. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one true God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Testament reading for the sixth Sunday after Trinity is from Exodus chapter 20. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children, to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
epistle is from Romans, chapter 6. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God, the Son, before all worlds, God of God, light of God, very God.
Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Let me say that one time. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. So when you hear that, and you think about that, do those words come to your heart, come to your mind, and bring comfort, bring joy, bring hope? Or do those words bring fear? Fear of God, fear of judgment, fear of consequences for human sin. Of course, the other possibility is it's both, right? And in fact, it is both. Because you look at it one way, you look at it another way, you hear it one way, you hear it the other way. And both these things, both these responses are the intended responses. Both these responses are legitimate responses. When you hear these words, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees. So when it comes to God's righteousness, the biblical way of talking about righteousness is this. It has to do with the law. And the law, we've read the law, we got it today in Exodus chapter 20, Ten Commandments, about God, about his name, about the right worship of God, about authorities, about murder, about marriage, about stealing, about lying, about coveting. We had all of it there laid out for us. And we know what the law is. And the truth is, even before the law is recorded, inscribed in tablets of stone, the law of God has been written on our hearts. That's how it was at the very beginning. Adam and Eve knew what the law was. They failed to keep it. And all human beings born into this world after the fact are born with the law of God written on their hearts. And so righteousness then, in the end, is about standing before God. Have you kept the law or have you not kept the law? Righteousness is about your standing before God without sin or with sin. And the deciding factor, the determining factor, the sin factor is, if you kept the law, you have no sin. If you haven't kept the law, even to the smallest degree, you're still a sinner and you're still unrighteous before God. And so this is how righteousness works. This is what the law is all about. This is how standing before God is established, or standing before God is taken away. Well, then there's the question. How do the Pharisees fit into this discussion? How do the Pharisees fit in with Jesus' discussion here of the righteousness of God? And the Pharisees fit in, the scribes and the Pharisees, they fit in this particular way. When it comes to the scribes, but in particular when it comes to the Pharisees are a kind of an experiment. The experiment of the Pharisees was this. Is it possible for us to keep the law and keep the law perfectly as God demands? That's what Phariseeism was all about. It was adherence to the Word of God. They believed in the Word of God. They weren't liberal or something like this. They held to it absolutely. And their desire was to keep the law perfectly. And why is this? Because they knew what took place in the desert. That Israel went out in the desert and could have had that express journey from Egypt to the Promised Land. But no, because of human sin, we're waylaid in the Promised Land for 40 years. But worse than that, the Babylonian captivity, being deported from the Promised Land, Israel itself, being taken away and enslaved by these foreign nations, these foreign peoples, being deprived possibility of going to the temple, being deprived of the possibility, say, of meeting with God's people in that way. And then 70 years later, coming back, rebuilding the walls, rebuilding the temple, rebuilding the civilization, rebuilding the priesthood, and all those kinds of things. And that all could have been avoided. That's their idea. It didn't have to be the failure that it was. We didn't have to be taken out of the Promised Land. We did not have to suffer the way we suffered for those 70 years in captivity. If we had kept the law, if we had kept the law that God had given to us. So when it comes to this law, I hope you're kind of feeling it. It's a burden, it's a weight, it's weighing down on you. Because the standards here are not best efforts, the standards here are perfection. You see, the thing we deal with more than anything else these days, in the church and even outside of the church, is people read that law, people understand that law for what it is, they even begin to feel the burden. Burden of keeping it perfectly according to God's own demands. And what they say is, well, God certainly couldn't have been serious about this because we can't keep it. And so people begin to take away from the law. People begin to add to the law. People begin to massage the law with a kind of an understanding. Maybe God didn't mean that. Or maybe this had to do with cultural practices back in the day, but since culturally we no longer hold to these things are no longer sin. But we have to rule all of that out. And one of these hymns in particular was about this, because the law of God is always good. The word of God is always good. The word of God is always God's word. Cannot be retracted, cannot be edited in that sense. The word of God is what it is. It's a reflection of God. It's a reflection of his nature. It's who he is. It's what he believes. It's what we must believe as well. And that's just how it is. We don't get to submit our edits after the fact. We don't get to go in like Wikipedia there and make our edits based on what's taken place, even in this day and even at this time. The word of God is what it is. The law of God is what it is. And we must keep it perfectly. We must keep it absolutely. And so then Jesus comes in here, and what he says is, it's not enough, it's not sufficient for us to be equal to the scribes and the Pharisees, who more than anybody else devoted their lives to the keeping of the law, even created laws outside of the law to prevent you from falling into this sin or that sin and the other sin. So the 10 are not enough, we're adding all these extras, and it's for your benefit. So it's not enough even for us to equal what the scribes and Pharisees were able to do with their practices and their desires. What does Jesus say? Our righteousness has to exceed that of the scribes, has to exceed that of the Pharisees. Or, as a consequence, what? You will, notice the word, never enter the kingdom of God. Never, by no means, there's no access whatsoever, unless your righteousness exceeds that of scribes and Pharisees, you're out. That's what Jesus says. And so we reflect on these words, we reflect on the law, and we have to ask ourselves, are we even at the same level as scribes and Pharisees? Are we exceeding scribes and Pharisees? And the answer is going to be no. Not at all. And it's not so much that it's about effort and we're not trying. It's that when Jesus says you have to exceed the scribes and Pharisees, he's laying down the standard, perfection. And after the fall, perfection is not a possibility for us under the law. We might be good at certain things, good at other kinds of things. When it comes to the law, we'll never reach the status of perfectly keeping the law. It's not even a possibility. It wasn't a possibility for scribes and Pharisees. How do we know? The temple was in business every day, all day. Sacrifices to God because of human sin. So it was never the case that scribes and Pharisees ever achieved perfection under the law. They were offering the sacrifices because they were sinners. And the same is true for us. We're in that exact same situation. As Christians, even, our greatest desire is to keep the law. That's definitely true. But because of the fallen human nature that remains with us, because of the sinful nature that remains with us, that is to be taken away on the last day, we have this struggle. And we've been talking about it here by way of sermons, but we've been also talking about this in the Bible study. That this is exactly the predicament of the Christian person, is this conflict between these two natures, which keeps us, prevents us from keeping the law at that level of perfection. So then here's the question, here's our issue. If we can't do it, we can't even try to do it and be successful. There is no capacity, there is no possibility of pulling this off according to Jesus' own demands. I have not come to abolish the law. The Then what are we left with? Where can we turn? Well, the answer to this question, quite happily, is to Jesus. And that's why you can look at these words up front, unless your righteousness exceeds that of scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of God. And not just have that kind of fear that goes along with that, but begin to have the kind of joy that God desires for you to have. To begin to have the kind of hope that God desires for you to have. To begin to have the kind of faith that God grants you through things like means of grace, like the word itself. Because while it's true that we cannot do it and we cannot pull it off, this is the exact reason. This is the express purpose for sending us Jesus Christ. This is it. Miracles and other kinds of preaching and teaching. I mean, this is part of learning about the kingdom of heaven. This is part about learning about God and his grace. That's true. But the real purpose, the intended reason for sending us Jesus Christ, was for this purpose of carrying out the law, bearing the burden of the law, suffering under the law. That's what the incarnation is all about, especially at the beginning. And by standing in our place, by carrying our burdens under the law, by taking all of the sins of the world upon his shoulders, he's taking them away from you. He's taking those things away from me. We can't do it. We don't have the ability to do it. He can does it. He has the ability. And more than anything else, this is what he desires to do. This is the good and gracious will of God that is revealed to us in Jesus Christ. That he comes to us not to affirm or to confirm our failures under the law, but to take them away from us entirely. And so the beginning here, in terms of his life and his ministry, is he does have that life as the righteous man. He keeps the law. He keeps his Father's will. He preaches and teaches. He heals. He does all things that have been given to him by God. He's the righteous man. He's the righteous person where we are not. And he does all that on our behalf. But in addition to that, because there are sins that have been committed, there are sins that have to be overcome, atoned for, forgiven. You have to be redeemed from that sinful situation. Jesus takes his place as sinner in a place that is reserved for sinners, under the wrath of God, on the cross itself of Calvary. If you think that sin's not really that big of a deal, we begin to think that sin's not so significant. If you look to the cross, you see the answer, you see the truth of what the consequences of human sin are. Death. But it's in that same cross, it's in that same suffering and dying, we also see God's love revealed to us. We also see God's desires to forgive sinners and not condemn them in their sins revealed to us. In that dying of the Christ on the cross for us, we have that righteousness of God being created. We have that righteousness of God being established. We have that righteousness of God that is demanded by God, so that God can then take all of who Christ is, all that Christ has done, everything that there is to do with the Christ, and grant it to you. He gives it to you in your baptism. Sort of what the epistle is about to some degree. That in our baptisms, we've come to receive all that Christ is. We receive his death. We also receive his resurrection. He receives our sins. He receives our failures. We receive his righteousness. We receive even his eternal life. In the Christ, he has taken our place under the law. In the Christ, he has taken our place in terms of saving us from sin itself. So baptism, again, is how we begin to receive that. The word of God, when it comes into our ears and goes into hearts and minds. Sure, we have that kind of doubt, say, up front, but that doubt, by way of the Holy Spirit, is taken away. Why? Because what Christ has done. Even in the Lord's Supper, in terms of means of grace, Christians come forward, and in that body and in that blood, what we are receiving is no less than that same body and that same blood that was incarnate, that same body, that same blood that was given and shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. And so these words, I have to admit up front, whenever I read them, they do begin to stir up things like fear of the wrath of God. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of God. Because God is right to judge those who fail to keep the law. But because of what we know about Christ now, because we've come to reject our ability and our capacity to do anything to save ourselves and throw ourselves entirely at the feet of God, entirely at the mercy of God, what we find there is God is merciful. And the righteousness that he demands, he gives. The righteousness that is required is fulfilled. By who? Not by us, but by Christ. The Christ who did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. He has fulfilled the law. You have access to the kingdom of heaven. You have the kingdom of heaven. And the reason you have it is because of Christ. Because of this Jesus, born of the Virgin Mary, who lived, who suffered, who died, who rose. Those things, that person, those facts about his life, they grant to you that righteousness before God that is required if you will enter the kingdom of heaven. You have that righteousness. It's given to you. You have that great gift of God. It's given to you. And now that we know this, now that we know that it's a gift, now we know that we could never have earned it and worked our way toward it, but God grants it to us entirely, without conditions. The only thing that we could possibly do now that we've received it, now that we know about it, now we've begun to appreciate it, is to give thanks to God for the blessings and the gifts that he grants to us through Christ, even righteousness itself, righteousness that brings us into the kingdom of heaven. And so for this Christ, and for all that he has done for us, we offer our thanks. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. He writes, peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In thanksgiving for Christ, whose innocent sufferings and death has freed us from the prison of everlasting death, that we may trust in his righteousness which covers all our sins, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For God's people, they would receive the spirit of peace and reconciliation, and so live together in forgiveness and harmony. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all Christian people, that God would give his Holy Spirit, teach us to honor authority, protect life, cherish marriage, respect possessions, defend reputations, and be content with the gifts that he gives us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all fathers and mothers, pastors and teachers, that God will guide them and bless them as they bring up children in wisdom and in favor with God and man, to live a holy life and to love their neighbors as themselves. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those afflicted by any adversity, whether of body or soul, especially Max, Frank, Tammy Groves, Winnie, Rob, Carolyn, Jeanette, Deborah, Kathleen, Gladys, Robin, Mark, Joanne, Teresa, and all those who are afflicted by wind or flood, that God would lead them by his Spirit to renew strength and peace. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who receive the Lord's body and blood this day, that forgiven of their sins and bound to God in his communion of love, they would also gladly forgive the sins of their brothers and sisters, and let no division arise at this holy table. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Heavenly Father, for the sake of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I exhort you in Christ that you give attention to the testament of Christ in true faith, and above all, take to heart the words of which Christ presents his body and blood to us for forgiveness, that you take note of and give thanks for the boundless love that he showed us when he saved us from the wrath of God, sin, death, and hell by his blood, and that you then externally receive the bread and wine, that is his body and blood, as a guarantee and pledge. Let us then, in his name, according to his command, and with his own words, administer and receive testimony. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, for Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
thank you.
when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
to the Lord, for he is good.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us, stand in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The Lord be with you. Thank you.
district has come back and given us the requirements for constitutional bylaws that's going to be passed and accepted, which we have accepted. And so it's changed what we delivered to them. Not changed in any significant way, but changed a little bit here or there. And so we're going to vote on that next week. We vote on that next week, and we should have our constitutional bylaws approved by the district on July 23rd. So if you'd like the details on that, there are printed constitutional bylaws in the back, and the additions are in red, and there's about 10 of them. And like I said, they're mostly things that are generally insignificant or detailed type of changes. If you have any questions about that, ask me on the way out. July 27th, Family Fun Day for church and school, so please plan for that. It's 2 to 6 p.m. There's going to be a bouncy house, snow cones, all those sorts of things. And it's a way to get some, to know some of the church families, and also for them to get to know some of the church members. So please plan on attending. That's July 27th. As we depart, please greet one another, but especially our guests. Heart and peace.